God who's been a part of the service so far, amen. Would you divine choir and praise him, amen. Tomorrow, Louisa, thank you so very much for leading us through. Our community stewards, thank you so very much. Our readers, thank you so very much. And always our ushers, thank you so very much. Amen. Hallelujah. God has shown us good all the time. Amen. Do I have a witness in the house of God's goodness? Amen. Amen. If you don't believe it, I want you to know it was not your alarm that woke you up this morning. Amen. If you fell back or not last night, I know somebody didn't fall back. Amen. But our God, hallelujah, you still have a plan for our lives. Amen. It's the one who woke us up this morning. Somebody was in here today and didn't even want to come to church. Hallelujah. When God saw fit, that said there was a word or a song or a verse, something. Hallelujah. Something that would bring you here because the Lord wants to speak to you on this day. Amen. Hallelujah. Give you glory and honor and praise. I'm going to be coming today from the Habakkuk scripture. I'm not sure if I've ever preached from Habakkuk before. Habakkuk is one of the 18 prophetic books in the Old Testament. It's a short book. It's only 3 chapters. But we'll talk a little bit about what Habakkuk was going through and why he wrote this and what it means to us. I want to start by telling you about my friend Roderick. So Roderick had lived a really good life. And he was like so many of us that grew up in the church. He grew up in the church, went to Sunday school and all that, but when he got old enough, so many of us, Roger strayed away from the church. And he was doing his own thing, but he went to school and he got a great job and everything was going well. His career was going well, he got married, his family was going well, everything was going well. So he was interviewing for a job. And he went into the interview, and for those who've gone to an interview, and you had, you know, anybody gone to an interview, and you knew you had a job, you know, you just like, I killed that. I had to call the police. I killed that thing. And so he had killed this interview, and he knew that he had this job. It was his dream job, the job that he always wanted his entire life. And so he was so confident that he had got the job, but 2 days later, he quit his present job. I said, don't do that. He said, I got this thing. I'm going to quit my job. And so he went a whole week, and he didn't hear from the job. And the other thing is, you know, anybody ever applied for a job and you had somebody on the inside who was working for you? Yeah. Somebody telling you that what they're saying, you know. And so his inside contact told him, oh, man, the job is yours. Second week, ain't heard nothing. He started getting a little nervous because when he quit his job, he didn't tell his wife. Happy wife, happy life, man. He ain't going there. But he's getting a little worried. He's getting a little worried. And so it had been a long time, but he started to pray. Man, Lord, come on, Lord. You know I got this job. My resume was perfect. My interview was great. I know I got this job, Lord, please. Please, Lord God. Third week.
Nothing.
He ain't heard nothing. Not only did not he hear from the job, he ain't heard nothing from God. He's really a music. So all of a sudden, Robert comes to church. See, you know how it is, because a lot of times something has to go really, really wrong for people to come to church. Amen. Amen. Some people saw him in church like, ooh, Robert's here. Something wrong. And so Robert went to church. Robert came up for altar call. And Robert was praying for this job. He said, Lord God, I've got to get this job. Lord, I got to get this job. Next week, didn't hear a thing. And so he got real anxious and he was getting all nervous. He was like, so he called up there. You know he wasn't supposed to call. He called up there to see if they had given away his job. The job he knew was his. And they said, no, we haven't hired anybody yet. They just haven't made a decision. He was getting really, really nervous. And so he was wondering why he had not heard from the job, and he had not heard from God, and he was getting ready. He said, okay, I got to humble myself and go back to my old job, which I quit, to see if I can get my job back. And in our text this morning, we have Habakkuk the prophet, and he was waiting on God to move as well. Habakkuk was going through because God had allowed him to see some things that left him very disturbed. That Habakkuk was a prophet, he was a seer. And so what we read in these chapters have not occurred yet. And so God had shown him these things, and when he saw these things, he was so upset that he asked questions of the Lord, and it's okay to ask questions of the Lord. And then he began to complain to the Lord about what was going on. And so he asked the Lord, he was asking the Lord questions, and the Lord would not answer. And he waited, and he waited, and he waited. So this text this morning will give us a better idea, an understanding of how God works even for us. When we lift up a prayer to him, when we have a concern, even when we complain to God, because that's okay too. But I want you to see and understand what happened to Habakkuk, and understand that the same thing, God still works in these ways. And the title of the sermon is going to be Wait and Live by Faith. Wait and live by faith. Let's pray. Lord, we ask that you would move at this time in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, speak to us. There's a word, I believe. There's a word for everybody in this place today. It won't be the same word for everybody.
Come on.
But something will be said that comes from high. And Lord God, I pray they don't miss it. I pray, Lord God, they don't pick it for somebody else when it's good for them. So Lord God, have your way in this place. Use me as your instrument to deliver your word. And Lord, we will give you the glory. This is our prayer in the awesome name of Jesus. We pray and say,
Amen.
Amen. So here is Habakkuk the seer. And what God has allowed him to see was how bad things were going in Judah. So now Judah was one of the two, this is the Old Testament, this happened somewhere around 600 BC, which would be 600 years before Christ. And the Palestine, what we know as Palestine, was divided by the two kingdoms, which was Israel and Judah. Judah was the southern kingdom of the Israelites, where Jerusalem was. And so Habakkuk was in Judah, and what he was seeing was total disruption. Everything was going on. God's chosen people who were there were acting like they had lost their mind. There was decay and violence and greed and fighting and destruction, and injustice was all around him. He was wondering, he's looking around, he was wondering, with all this mess going on, God, when you gonna show up? Look, I mean, you see all of this violence. You see your people doing all this stuff. God, when are you going to show up? It appeared that wickedness was ruling the day. We see in Habakkuk 1 and 2, he comes out and asks this question, how long? How long, Lord God? And as I read it, I was thinking, this was written so many years, thousands of years ago, but it could apply to us right now. As we look at all of the stuff that's going on around us, we ask the same question, Lord, how long? How long, Lord God, before you put away injustice? How long, mass incarceration? How long, inequitable education? How long, discrimination? How long, drugs and opioids? How long will our people continue to kill each other? How long, Lord God, will our men in our community see babies but refuse to be fathers? How long, Lord God, we have to, how long, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, will the breaking news always be about murder or rape or political injustice, fires and wars and rumors of wars? Today we ask the question, Lord, how long? How long the violence? How long the destruction? How long will we have to deal with the mess that flows from 1600 Pennsylvania? How long? See, Habakkuk was looking at the same stuff. When the wicked people seemed to be ruling everything, and the righteous were afraid, and the righteous could do nothing, and he was asking the Lord God, he said, how long do you want me to look at this trouble and you do nothing? How long this violence and this destruction? instruction. And Lord God, you don't even show up. And so the basic question from Habakkuk is, Lord God, what are you going to do? See, he took his complaint directly to God, and that is what we too are allowed to do. This was called an oracle, and basically what it was in the Hebrew was called a massa, M-A-S-S-A, which means a burden. This was burdening him. This was a weight on him. And so what he did is what we can do. He took his burden to the Lord. He took his burden to the Lord. He was waiting for an answer. You see, this experience tells us that we too can take our burden to the Lord. And even when he does not answer in the way that we expect. See, here's the thing. And what we will see later on is that we can ask God a question. But so many times, even in Jesus in the New Testament and God in the Old Testament, you ask God a question and he don't answer that question.
Come on.
Because God knows what you really need to hear. So I came by to tell you today to let you know. So I don't want you to miss it. You won't ask, we pray to God, and we ask God to do this and do that, we ask God for something. When God gives an answer, just because it's not what you asked, does not mean that it's not supposed to be applied to your life. Because God knows what you need to hear, and he's not going to give you what you want to hear. He knows what you need to hear, and I want someone to understand, y'all got to wait on God. God is not in no hurry, because what God is doing is he's moving things in the background, setting things up perfectly, because this is God's plan, amen, and we are on God's time. It's called chronos. It's God's time, not our time. We get all upset and we get mad because God, I ain't answering my prayer. I prayed 15, God, come on now, God ain't worried about you. God is not worried about you or what God is saying. Look at here. I have a great plan for your life. So don't try to run up ahead of God. So many people, we try to run. Well, I didn't get no answer, so I'm going to go get anyone. You cannot outrun God. I thought by this morning to let you know our God is faster than Usain Bolt and anybody else who's out there trying to run. And he's faster than you too. So what we have to learn to do is wait on the Lord. We have to be willing to wait. Let me tell you, see, the difference in Habakkuk, between Habakkuk 1 and Habakkuk 2 was almost 20 years. He kept asking, how long? How long, Lord God? How long? Just gotta wait. We have to be patient and wait because, and I know I have more than one witness in the house.
Yes.
That you prayed for something years ago and it's just coming to fruition. So here's the key. Here's no lesson for somebody. When, you know, first thing, we keep journals, and so it's like, when I ask the Lord something, I write it down, because here's what I don't want to happen. You asked the Lord something 10 years ago, right? Wasn't time. Wasn't God's time. 10 years later, you get blessed, but you forgot. You forgot that you asked God for it, and when you forget, what happens is, then you forget to give God glory. You forget to give God the praise for what the prayer was answered. So I came by today to let you know. Oh, come on, Holy Spirit. That the prayers that you've been praying, I want you to know God has heard them. He has heard them. And he has not answered them. Just turn to him and say, neighbor. Excuse my English, Mr. Brown. Sorry. It ain't time yet. Turn to the neighbor. It just ain't time. See, we have to learn to be patient with God, and we have to believe by faith that God is working things out, that God is putting things together that we can never understand, because most of the time when he blesses us, it's beyond everything that we ask for. And then, oh, you didn't know you're going to bless me like that. I want to thank you. You took your little time to go, God, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. So I just want you to know that the prayers that you deposited in the 1990s, hallelujah, God heard them then. The prayers that you deposited in the early 2000s, he heard you. I need for somebody to grasp this. It's not over till God says it's over and the prayer is not answered until God is ready to answer your prayer. Do I have a witness in the house with you? Lord, how long are you going to wait?
well, they don't do anything. We didn't read it, but if you go a little bit deeper into Habakkuk, in Habakkuk 5, 1 and 5, he says this. He says, look at the nations and watch, and be utterly amazed. For I'm going to do something in your days that you would not believe, even if I told you. I am raising up the Babylonians and that ruthless and impetuous people who will sweep across the whole earth to seize dwelling places of their own. They are a feared and dreaded people, and they are the law of themselves, and they promote their own honor. And Habakkuk had to say, you're going to do what? You're going to do what? So what God was saying is, see, what happened, because of all the destruction and all the violence, that the people of Judah had been disobedient. And so we all need to understand, in the name of Jesus, come on, speak Holy Spirit, that our disobedience will be punished by God. You know, we can't get away with that. We cannot get away with disobedience. And so he said, what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring the Babylonians to wipe everybody out. Ooh-wee. That's like saying, come on in, ISIS, come on, man. Yeah, everybody, we just gonna blow up everybody. It was that bad. The Babylonians were becoming the most powerful nation in the world, and they were just beating and killing and enslaving everybody. And here God says, I'm gonna send them to get you right. Uh-oh. You see, sometimes God has to get our attention. You know, you've been doing what you want to do, how you want to do it, where you want to do it. Been doing that creep, 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 creep thing in the back, you know what I'm saying? Was it alone in the corner to God, all that stuff that you've been doing, and God knows that you've been doing it, there is a penalty that you have to pay. Power, and that's the watchtower. And so when that was the ramparts, the highest place where you can go and look and see if the enemy is coming. And so what he was saying was, I'm going to position myself so that I can hear from the Lord. So I need you to understand this, that when he says that we need to go to our ramparts, so the lesson here is, as we pray and ask God for something, we need to go to our rampart, but our rampart is not a physical location. Our rampart is a mental and spiritual location that we position ourselves in a place where we can hear from God. Let me tell you this morning, you can't hear God watching the football game. You can't hear God, even as great as the World Series was, go Nats. You can't hear God if you're watching too much of the World Series. You can't hear God watching your soap opera. You can't hear from God watching your story or your game show. In other words, to get to your rampart, you need to go to your prayer closet. You need to go somewhere where no one is there, where you're all alone, where you can focus on hearing from God. And here's another thing, and first lady was, and I was talking about this on the way here. You see, what you hear from God, you have to understand that it comes from God, whether you like it or not. Don't miss it. Oh, man, that, like, I ain't asked for that. That must have been. Let me tell you, let me, I actually want to let you know. Our God has never dialed the wrong number. So that's what God has for me, he has for me. And that's whether you like it or not. And sometimes the news we get from God, we are not going to like. It's not going to be all of the news we receive from God. The news he got. He said, God's going to destroy your people. He does not always give us good news, but then he told him, he said, look at here. That's a part of the story. Oh, watch this. But the story is not over till God says it's over. He told me, he said, look at here. He said, this is what I'm going to do, but I need for you to write the vision and make it plain. Write it on a tablet so when the runner has it, everybody will be able to read it. And so that's what he says, and if it tarries, in other words, if the message that I give you takes a little while, you just got to hold on. Because God is moving. You see, what we need to understand is just because we don't feel it and just because we don't see it does not mean God is not moving on our behalf. I believe in the name of Jesus. I don't know about you, but by faith, I believe in the name of Jesus that every time I look at the prayer, God is doing something. I may not see it for a year. I may not see it for 2 years or 3 years, but I believe by faith that God is making a way. God is moving mountains out of the way. God is opening doors. God is opening windows. God is, oh, do I have a witness in the house this morning? Who can believe with me? And God heard your prayer. And God to wait. And in our waiting does not mean that we just sit and get a guitar and learn how to sing the blues. In our waiting, we still do what God has called us to do because we go by faith. At the end of the passage in verse 2, it tells us that the righteous live by faith. In other words, with all kind of stuff and mess swirling all around us, with all kind of sorrow, with all kind of death, we live by faith, believing that our God is going to make a way out of nowhere. We believe by faith that God is going to change some things. We believe by faith powerful God, that this mighty God is going to come in, step in, and do exceedingly and abundantly more than we ask, think, and imagine, no matter what our eyes may see, no matter what may be going on. We need to know that by faith, God is moving on our behalf because we are children of the Most High God, and this God loves us. Do we know God loves us? This God loves us. This God has a great plan for us. This God has a great plan for us. And so just hold on just a little while longer. Isaiah wrote that they that wait on the Lord will renew their strength in the name of Jesus. We have to be willing to wait on God. Sometimes we just get so tired of waiting on God. But I came by this morning to let you know God is not in a hurry. We're the only ones in a hurry. And if you just wait on God and wait for him to move, just like he did the last time, when you wait on the Lord, God will come through. If I have a witness, just give the Lord a hand. Amen. But this God just doesn't do any of the things that we want to do when we want him to do it. But he does have a great plan for our lives. Wait on the Lord and renew your strength. He said, write the vision. And the vision was that the righteous live by faith. See, he wanted to keep it easy. Because the son, he said, write it, and then a runner was going to take it. And so how he did it then was there was a runner, and he would be carrying the tablet, and he would run from city to city, and he would read it, and he would let the people see it. It was real simple. The righteous, those who are called, anointed, and appointed by God. I hope I have some righteous in the house this morning.
Come on.
I hope I have some righteous in the house this morning. I hope I have some righteous in the house this morning. Those who love God, those who want to live by God. Are there anybody who's glad? Are you glad that you are saved? Are you glad that he pulled you out of darkness into the dark room? Do I have anybody in the house this morning who is happy and glad that God showed up in your life, that you're not who you used to be? In the name of Jesus, do I have anybody? Somebody else who needs a savior is looking at you because you're the only savior. And so you are a life raft thrown into the pool of this world to say, somebody give God a hand praise. The righteous will live by faith. That means that no matter what your eyes see, no matter what your ears hear, no matter what's on the news, no matter what the president does, in the name of Jesus, we live by faith, not in the president or the political system. We live by faith of the God who said, I will send my son to save you. Of God who made a way, of God who heals you, of God who provides, of God who gave you I'm talking to the clock today. Of God who is a peacemaker. We live by faith in him that no matter what our eyes see, God will show up and show out. Oh my goodness, I got three people in here who believe that God is moving. That's the vision. Can you imagine? And we said, if it carries, hallelujah. You see, it says, like you see, in all this bad news that we're always getting, even in the stuff that's going on in the community, he says, I'm going to make a way. If everything's going to be all right, I got a plan. Everything that has happened is according to God's plan. He calls some of us home. He leaves some of us here because he's not finished with us yet. In the name of Jesus. All you have to do is wait and learn to live by faith. Live knowing. like a vision. Like the vision to make a plan. Psalms 27:14, wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart, but wait for the Lord. John 14:1, do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me. Nahum 1:7, for the Lord is good, a refuge in times of trouble. He cares for those who trust in him. Psalms 46:1, y'all know it. Our God is an ever-present help in the time of trouble. Jesus said, in this world, there's going to be trouble. He said, but I came. In the day I came, and I died that you might be free. I came. I want somebody to know you're free today. In the name of God, I need somebody to know. For a change may be near me. In the name of Jesus, we declare to break every chain. We declare you are free in Jesus' name. We declare you willing to fall by faith and not by sight. Your life will be changed. Now stand up on your feet and give the Lord a hand praise, like you know you just set you free. Hallelujah. 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 You see, sometimes God has to get our attention. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. All right, just like that, my boy Brian, God is attention. We five, Brian got the call. I'm sorry, man. Sorry, you just told us so long. Hope you didn't get tired of waiting. That's right. That's right. Somebody. I don't know about you. Somebody. I don't know about you. In the name of Jesus. Somebody just needs to wait. Hallelujah. Don't grow impatient, just wait. God is moving. God is on your side. God is on your side. God is on your side. Yeah, yeah. I haven't seen him. God is on your side. Hallelujah. This faith is not by what we see, it's about what we know in our hearts. That our God, hallelujah, I don't need no evidence that God is great and worthy to be praised in my life. So they gave Brock the job. But he knew that it was God. He started going to church regularly. He started praying regularly. He said, this time, Lord God, I'm not going to let it slip away. I'm going to hold to your hand. Out of my seal, God's unchanging hand. Somebody here, I'm talking to somebody. I may only be talking to one person today, but I want you to know, just be patient. God heard you. God heard that prayer. God heard that. God saw your tears in the name of Jesus. God said, I am just positioning you for greatness in the name of Jesus. Lord God, we give you glory. We give you honor and we give you praise, Lord God. Help us to wait on you, oh God. Help us, Lord God, to be patient and know that you are moving on our behalf. Help us to understand the love of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We can call the name of Jesus, and your word says that the righteous are safe. Help us, Lord God, not to believe the devil who's trying to say that God doesn't care anymore. Hallelujah. Lord God, in the name of Jesus, speaking to somebody this morning, to let you know everything's going to be all right. Everything's going to be all right. Just trust. Trust and believe. Trust and obey, but there's no other way. Hallelujah. So Lord God, we thank you for your word today. We thank you for the seeds. I pray that it's fallen on good soil this morning. In the name of Jesus, Lord God. And somebody needed that word. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Somebody needed that word. That burden they brought it here, they can just leave it here in the name of Jesus. They can be uplifted and know that we have power, wonder-working power. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord God, thank you. Thank you, Lord God, for allowing us to be your children. Thank you, Lord God, for your inheritance. Thank you, Lord God, hallelujah, for your word. Help us, Lord God, to write our vision and make it plain so that others may read as we run the race you're calling us to run. And God, we will give you the glory and the honor and the praise. This is our prayer. And all those who believe, all those who are willing to wait on God.
Thank you.